So I'm going to talk about the range of careers that there are available in the technology industry, because whenever I go out to schools or speak to teachers or parents, I think that a lot of people aren't really aware of how much choice there is out there. Oops. So when I was a little girl, I had no thoughts at all of working in the technology industry. I don't think we even had any computer classes in school. We did have, I remember, a room of computers, but we went in there once to do something on spreadsheets. That was pretty much it while I was in school. I didn't really know what I wanted to be when I grew up. And in the careers advisory, they had, you know, policeman or teacher or nurse or lawyer. And I didn't really know, you know, none of those sounded really exciting. My mum was a nurse, so I thought I definitely don't want to do that. And my dad did something mysterious in an office, and I thought, well, I would rather do that, but I didn't know what he did at all. And I think it is rather a mysterious world for the kids out there when they're thinking, what are my options? Can you tell which one's me? So... when people think about the IT industry, they tend to think of a couple of jobs. The first job is those guys that sit on the help desk and say, have you tried turning it off and on again? And in truth, that is where a lot of people start, because you don't require a huge amount of skills to start on a help desk. You just need to be able to sit there and allow yourself to be shouted at by people who are very annoyed and stay calm and try and find the answers to their questions. And yeah, ask them, have they tried turning it off and on again? Because that does fix it 80% of the time. I used to run a help desk and I used to recruit people to work on it. What got people an interview for that job was if they had got some IT qualification, maybe just a Cert 4 in IT, that'd be fine. The degree would be awesome, but you know, something to show that they had tried to apply themselves a little bit in technology. And if they had worked at McDonald's. The reason for that is people that work at McDonald's work for minimum wage while people who are much more stupid than them shout at them for stuff that isn't their fault. And if they could do that job for more than 6 months, then I think they could survive working on a service desk, which is much the same thing. And it does give them a good start into the world of IT, because anyone from the company could ring that person and ask them to fix a problem from any one of 2,000 applications, which is an impossible task for someone straight out of school or straight out of uni. But nevertheless, if those kids survive that job, then they can go on to do anything. I think they could be CEO of a company if they can survive that job for a year or so. It is where I started, and it is where a lot of people start, but it's not essential. I have a lot more respect for someone that's done that job. The other job that people think of when they think of the technology industry is developers or coders. I think we are all locked in darkened basements, eating pizza and coding, and probably on our own, in fact, and not talking to anyone. There is definitely a career in that, and if you can do that, there's a lot of money to be made, and there's a lot of flexibility, because in fact, you could do that job from home, you can do that job from Sydney, from Singapore, from Seattle. It doesn't make any difference where you are in the world, because you're just doing your thing, contributing to perhaps a program overall, and you just need to be able to code elegantly. So for people who are interested in numbers, in puzzles, in coding. And when I say coding, I mean when the kids are young and they go on adventures and they think of themselves as spies and they're using those little books where they translate stuff into another language, those kind of minds are the minds that do very well in the world of development. But those are only two of the careers that we have, and there's like a million others. This is only a small example slide, but there's a lot of stuff that isn't traditionally IT or technology, but are jobs that are engaged in IT companies. So I work for Microsoft, and in our Microsoft Perth office, there is not a single developer or coder in there. There's not a single help desk person in there. There is one engineer who I often bring with me to do talks like this. But apart from that, they're all, I don't know, sales and marketing types. They're all people that are out there talking to customers about technology, but not really deep dive understanding the technology in the same way that you'd think of it as a sort of the geeky guys in the first two slides. I have a little video that I always show kids at careers fairs. Now, the video is actually more than 10 years old, so the keyboards and phone that you see in there are pretty old-fashioned looking, but nevertheless, this is what my engineer does pretty much day to day.
Thank you.
So this is a picture of me at our internal Tech Ready conference in Seattle with some of the engineers that we have. And it is a pretty accurate representation. A lot of stuff can be done remotely these days, and we do have stuff done by offshore people in China or India or America, depending on what time of day or night it is, because you want to always have follow the sun support available to your customers. But when you do need an engineer to come to site, then we fly these guys in. And it is that glorious and that glamorous. I should say, yeah, what they do isn't all troubleshooting like that guy was doing there. They do a lot of proactive work, so they will go in and work side by side with a customer to look at how their environment looks now and say, this is where you are, this is where the best practice is, and then help accelerate what their teams know so that they can move from where they are to where the best practice is more quickly. So we don't put Microsoft people in sites to do the work of people from companies. We put people in for a little while to help train people up so that they can do that stuff for themselves. This guy is meant to represent the job that I do, which is service delivery manager. So my job is pretty much all about relationships. I have 5 or 6 customers, large customers, that are assigned to me. And it's my job to take care of them and make sure that anything they need from a Microsoft perspective, I will enable them to get that or do that or find the right person to help them with that. It's a pretty fun job, and I really like the customers that I have, but it's not something that you can do if you don't like people. It's not something you can do if you don't like working in teams. So the reputation that we have in the technology industry of being, you know, a bunch of nerdy people who like to be locked in a room by ourselves is not always true. So there are some roles where you can do that. If you like to work on your own, if you like mathematics, if you like code, you can do that. But if you like people, if you like teams, if you like getting out there and being part of the wider world, you can do that too. And there's also a sort of combination. If you like coding, but you like people as well, there are enormous projects that involve you working with multiple people across the world, but still doing coding type stuff. So for every type of person there is a job in technology that will suit them and will make them happy. You don't get a lot of time in schools, I think, to teach kids about technology. And a lot of the time, you haven't been taught very much about technology either. So when you hear about offering jobs to kids in technology, it can be pretty intimidating. But there are more and more organizations out there that are designed to take the pressure off a little bit. These guys are my absolute favorite one. These are called Coder Dojo, and they teach kids aged 7 to 17 how to code. And you can find them on the internet, but they have dojos in most of the major universities, and it happens at weekends, usually during term time. Sometimes they have camps out of term time. Other places have them as well, so I know Bank West has a dojo. And the beautiful thing about Coder Dojo is you do not need to know how to code yourself in order to teach kids how to code. It's it's a very each one teach one mentality, and they show you a lot of links and a lot of tools and a lot of stuff that you can just sort of let the kids play with it, and then the kids will teach themselves how to code and how to do stuff. So it's a very cool thing, and I know a lot of grandmothers that actually are mentors at Coder Dojo, because it's something they can do with their grandkids even though they don't know very much about code themselves, because there were never enough mentors for the number of kids that want to learn how to code. So no need to be intimidated. You can totally join up as a mentor and help out these guys, and then more kids can learn how to code. I did learn how to code in university, but I don't code now, and if anyone asked me to, I would not be able to do it. But it's a good thing to have a go at, to see whether you can, to see whether you like it or not. There is a kid called Thomas Suarez. Thomas Suarez, when he was 9 years old, he wrote his first app. By the time he was 12, he'd written 4 apps, and he used the profits from his first app to buy his own Xbox. The app, this is not Thomas Suarez, this is Justin Bieber. The app that Thomas wrote was called Bustin' Jeeber. It was a whack-a-mole game where you hit Justin Bieber over the head with a hammer. So you see, the simplicity of the game is instantly appealing to very many people, and kids who are 9 years old can learn how to do this by themselves. I think it's a pretty amazing industry that you don't even need to wait until you're 18 years old to start working in it. You can already have your own company. And he has his own company called Carrot Top or something like that. Already be earning your money and not be asking your parents for pocket money anymore. How cool would that be? There's more and more tools that make it pretty easy for kids to learn, but also for you guys to learn how to do stuff. And a lot of it is drag and drop these days, so you don't even, it's not even as hard as it was. Give it a go. This one is for the salespeople, of course. A lot of the industry is about sales and marketing, because when people go into a shop to buy their new laptop, or in business when they're trying to decide what solution it is that they can put in to upgrade the systems they have, there's such a vast array of stuff, and it's a little bit overwhelming. So what they are looking for is people to provide translation between the technical stuff and the business requirement, what the end users need. So you need to be able to understand a little bit of what the technology can achieve and a little bit of how it works, but you don't need to understand it deep dive. And so people who are salesmen or saleswomen at heart, people who like to provide a translation service between technical people and normal people, I guess, there are really a lot of roles doing that. This is a graphics designer. So for the artists, there is definitely a huge industry out there for them. Technology on its own is, if you left it to the geeks, it would be bare bones ugly and no one would be buying it. So a lot of it is about making it beautiful and making it advancing the way things look compared to how they used to do. I remember when I was a kid and we got our first computer, it was just like that ping pong thing where the thing is just moving across. Whereas nowadays the games look so clear, it's almost like a movie that you're seeing on the screen. And yet someone is designing that, someone is drawing that. I am going to talk a bit about games in a bit. Oh, this is architect. Solutions architect or systems architect, or in fact there is a whole family of jobs in technology called in the architect range. These are people that can look at the big picture and design a solution to match what enterprises need, what businesses need, or what end users need, but sort of linking it all together and putting it all in context. So they need to be big picture people, but they also need to be very technical. And so this is, I always think of this as a real technical god position, but it's no good if they can't speak to business. So they need to be able to bridge that gap. So those people that are comfortable with technology and comfortable with business language, this is an ideal job for them. Have any of you guys heard of Mark Rusinovich? So Mark is a god to us within the industry. Before he was 30 years old, he was a multimillionaire. How that happened was he wrote this set of tools called SysInternals. SysInternals were tools that you used with Windows PCs to find out what was going on with the computer, if it was, you know, chugging away and not doing anything, if it was running hot, if it was running slow, if maybe there were viruses on there, things like that. These tools could tell you that kind of information. And those tools were so good that Microsoft bought him and his company before he was 30 and gave him an awful lot of money and said, come work for us, you can do whatever you want when you're with us, but come. And so he came, and he's a technical king. I believe that is his exact title. But as well as writing all of this stuff about these tools, he's also written three fictional books, which will be turned into Hollywood blockbusters this year. So Zero Day, Trojan Horse, and Rogue Code are the three books that he's written. And they are really in that whole spy style, you know, action, adventure, Mission Impossible kind of stuff. In the first, pretty much on the first half page of the first book, something very rude happens. So it keeps you reading. But the thing about reading his fictional books is that it's really scary because you know that the situations he is describing in there to do with technology are real scenarios. It's stuff that has been done or can be done. It's mostly stuff that is being done right now. There are several things that he wrote in his books that a few months after the books were released, there was a big thing in the press saying that, you know, such a thing had occurred. So he's either predicting them or he's causing them. But yeah, it's good stuff. So yeah, if you're really smart and creative, you can do anything you want in technology. And he has done both sides of the fence. He's done the technical part, but he's also doing the artistic part. He's writing stories. Gaming is one of my favorite examples of how technology bridges everyone's area of interest. Because in gaming, you need the coders to write the code, but you also need people to write the music for the game. You need people to design the characters, to write the stories, to write the lines, to write the plots. So it really requires a lot of creative work to go in there to write the games. And I don't know if anyone is a gamer, but they are impossibly complex these days, and they really, it's a whole story, and some of them it's several stories, and often they make them into films as well, because it is an entirely different world out there. This is a picture of Perth Town Hall last year, and this is the Perth Games Festival. The Games Festival started at 10:30 in the morning, and I turned up at 10:35, and it was already this busy. When people think of our little town on the edge of the world, I don't think they think that we have a hugely thriving games industry here, but it turns out we do. All around the edges of the rooms, there were people who had written their own games, and they were playing them on all sorts of consoles, and they had mixed gaming devices that they just hashed together and made out of all sorts of stuff. And downstairs on the outside, they had non-technical games. So, you know, like card games and things like that as well, because the industry is not at all restrictive. It doesn't say we only care about digital games. If we're talking about games, we're talking about all games, and so it's very inclusive, and people cross over quite a lot. One of my favorite ladies in this town actually went to Curtin University and has one of the top 10 most downloaded PhDs from Curtin University, is Dr. Kate Rains-Goldie, and she is the Director of Games and Interactive at the Film and Television Institute in town. And she runs a Let's Make Games night thing on a lot of Friday nights, and people can come and they can make digital games or they can make non-digital games. And it's always super, super fun, and she's very inclusive of everyone. I think it's a good way for kids and for adults to think about getting into the industry. But the most important thing that I say to the kids whenever I go to schools or careers days is, it isn't really about what you think you should do when you grow up, or what you think will make you money, or what your parents tell you, or what your schools tell you. The important thing is to ask yourself, what do you really enjoy doing? What really makes you happy? What do you really like to do? And then try and pursue a career doing that. I think in technology, it is the field that you can do that in, because I think it has so many options and so many opportunities. But if it's not, you know, there's plenty of other places too, and they should be doing that. They should be doing what interests them and what inspires them. I have a little talk on YouTube called Where Have All the Girls Gone? And it's to try and encourage girls and young people as a whole into the technology industry. It also has a little reminder in there to each of us that the stories that we tell ourselves inside our heads, we shouldn't always listen to those stories if they're negative voices. We should listen to the positive voice and follow our dreams. Okay, does anyone have any questions? Did I send you all to sleep? It is a really good one. There is a really beautiful video that Verizon has done, which is obviously a US company and an advert for their technology, but it's a video aimed at girls and aimed at the messaging that we give to girls, and it's a video that shows a girl, and she's playing in a rock pool and fishing out starfish and stuff like that. And then you hear her parents say, "Oh, come away from there, you're getting dirty." And then you see her making a mural of the planets and things from the ceiling, and it's looking really good. And then you hear her mum saying, "Oh, come, like, leave that now, it's gotten out of hand." And then you see a thing where she's building a rocket with her brother, and her parents shout, "Come away from there, leave that to your brother, it's too dangerous for you." And then you see her walking towards a glass cabinet that has a science fair poster in it, and as she gets to the glass cabinet, she takes out her lipstick and puts it on, and then walks away. And it's a reminder to us that the things that we say are perhaps the things that are turning our girls away from all of the career options they could be having. What I say to girls is, I don't know if you were in David Cook's lecture earlier, but the technology field is ideally suited to women. It is actually ideally suited to everyone, but for people who want flexible working, who do not need to be somewhere between 9 and 5, who want to work from home or from Sydney, Singapore, Seattle, wherever they are, the IT industry is the key one for that. You don't need to be lifting heavy stuff. You don't need to be driving heavy stuff. It's normally, as long as you have an internet connection, you can do your job from anywhere in the world. when I go to Seattle or when I go to Sydney, which I will do this year, I don't even need to tell my customers that I'm not in town, because they email me or they phone me and I can just email them the information back. If they want to see me, you know, I'll say I'll see you the week after and I'll be back then. But there's nothing really that requires me to be in a set place, to be in an office, to be clocking in and out, to be doing anything that is difficult for me. And I like that. I really like that flexibility. I like that choice. And I don't know why anyone would choose anything else. Dr. Kate Rains Goldie. Yeah. So she works at the Film and Television Institute, but she has on Facebook quite a lot of different groups. I think Let's Make Games. I think that's one you can find on Facebook, with which advertises the games nights that she runs. If you look up the Perth Games Festival, if you go there, you'll find a lot of these groups there. So Dr. Kate will be there, and the Coda Dojo guys will be there, Robo Gals will be there. Because it's very open, so it doesn't even have to be specifically games, but a lot of the people within the industry support each other, and so we'll be there to do that. So I would say, if they are thinking of going to university, but I'm not by any means saying they have to do that, but if they were thinking of going to university, they should pick the most generic technology course, because if you specialize in something, that technology might not be there the year after. And they should take some minors in business, or commerce, in marketing, in something else, like vary it out a bit and make it wide, unless they are full-on maths geeks who love computers and nothing else, in which case, let them take full code. But if there is any opportunity to sort of diversify it a bit and take some business courses in there, I'd say do that. And if they're not going to go to university, if they're just going to take some other more vocational courses, something that gives them a chance to learn how to code, just so they can tell whether they like that or not, and something that has a little bit of a business spin on it as well, or communications or customer service, something that makes them industry ready, because they're able to talk about the skills that they have. Extra credit. Write that down, everyone. there is really a lot of different choices out there on the internet, and it's the same with coding. Like, I would say I didn't like any coding language apart from Prolog, because of the way that my brain works, it's not at all object orientated. So for some people, there is a coding language out there, it isn't necessarily the one you learn. And the same with studying. You might find different ways to study that don't appeal to you, and then you come across something like extra credit and you think, this really speaks to me and this makes it easy for me to understand. So Khan Academy is really good, Coursera is really good. if you look for like We Speak Code or Coder Dojo, they all have resources out there that, you know, there's a lot of stuff out there that can help you just have a little bit of a view and help you have a try at something.